checkpoint this week, we are looking at school fees hike. But before we do that, I will introduce to you the gentleman with whom I'm going to be discussing this topic. On my extreme left is Brother Godfrey Lutaya, who is also the headmaster of Mugwanya Preparatory School, Kaboja. We also have Mr. Patrick Kaboyo, who also runs a school, a private school, Mpongo Parents Nursery and Primary School in Chenjojo. Glad to have you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Nice being here once again.
Good evening to you. How are you doing?
Good evening, Vivian.
Yes.
We are fine.
That's nice to know. That is nice to know. Mm. Now, lately, schools were directed by the Ministry of Education not to increase school fees, but they have done just exactly what the ministry told them not to do. And the reason is that they too are going through the same economic environment that the teachers, that their parents are also going through, and that they need more funds to run the schools. So the parents have to dig deeper into their pockets to have their children attain an education. And the increasing cost of living in this economy, honestly, is not helping in that situation. I will start with you, brother. Has your school increased school fees?
Yes, we have increased this year.
Why?
Because we couldn't continue operating without increasing school fees. There is no way you can put a cap on some institutions and leave others to continue hiking costs. We live in a society. We live in the same country. Petroleum products are hiked. Foodstuffs are hiked. We started the year when we are buying a kilogram of posho, maize flour, just one example, at 1,500. We ended the year when the same kilogram of maize flour was costing us 5,000 shillings. Okay, that's now how do we survive? If you cannot, if the cost of living has increased in your homes, a school is a home away from home. That's the way I understand it. Now, how do you expect really the schools to survive? Actually, when the ministry insisted and the parliament insisted that we don't increase tuition, particularly with us in the boarding section, the person I felt like, incidentally, I even asked to retire, to leave teaching all the same, because I knew we were just going to close the school. We're just going to close, that's all.
Is it that serious?
Yes, it's that serious. The problem I see here is there is this feeling, I think by the general public, that schools increase tuition unnecessarily.
Yes.
And that's a misconception. For instance, in my school, there is no single year when we don't give accountability to the parents. We sit with the parents, and in most cases, they are the same people who tell us, please, to help this kind of area, can we increase tuition? Please put some little money on each child, and then we discuss that. How much can we put so that we get this kind of service, okay, in our school? And that's what we do. We give them accountability. We have auditors, both government auditors and private auditors, and we give them that kind of accountability. Actually, for us in Mugwanya Preparatory School, Kaboja, I may not know what others are doing elsewhere. Well, the moment you we have a budget, we never open an academic term without the sitting of the management to approve that budget. And the policy is that at the end of the term, the income must be equal to the expenses. No surplus, no deficit. That's what we get. Apart from last year, of course, we ended up in deficits. The moment you have a surplus, the management will tell you why are you cheating the parents? Are you cheating the parents? Are you here to make profits? We are not a profit-making school. For us, we are. Actually, I've seen many schools around us parking up, even those who charge more than we charge, parking up and they close. For us, we are always there. Whether parents pay or not, it's actually the parents who direct us. For us, it's about teaching. It's our mission. We are brothers of Christian instruction, and our mission is teaching. Whether, parents are paying or they are not paying, we shall stay there. We shall always be there. Our teaching congregation actually started in France during the French Revolution, and it was teaching poor children who were just roaming streets, and they were hardly paying money.
Talking so about that's paying for an education, we do have a video which I want you to look at, just to talk about education for a pay, how much did it cost. Some other stakeholders are also very concerned about the cost of education and how the quality of education is matching the school fees hikes that we see. We did have that video last week on Friday, and UNATU specifically, which is a stakeholder in your sector, is concerned about that. Let's have that video.
From the study done by Uganda National Teachers Union and Education International on the rapid assessment of privatization and commercialization of education in Kampala metropolitan area, private schools and education institutions outnumber public early child education, primary and secondary schools.
But the challenges of UPE and USE schools have been exploited by some investors to establish private education institutions, in most cases within close proximity to the public schools, with the intention of making profits from those that cannot gain admission in public schools.
To make matters worse, the study indicates that private participation in education is motivated by financial gains and not about extending education as a service to the people.
Some private schools are very expensive, and what is marketed as quality education is in most cases as a result of intensive coaching of students, learners to pass the national examinations.
Speaking at the launch of the campaign to stop privatization and commercialization of education, Philbert Baguma, the General Secretary of UNATU, expressed concern that education is gradually becoming for the privileged few. He noted that parents are struggling to take back their children to school because of high tuition fees and unrealistic requirements.
The schools were almost empty, and the parents were running up and down. Those who had raised the school fees could not raise the money for requirements.
UNATU says rapid commercialization of education is promoting intensive coaching instead of quality education and compromising teacher qualification by hiring less qualified teachers who will accept low salaries, therefore undermining the national education standards.
On issues of teacher qualification, most of the private schools hire less qualified teachers and pay low salaries as a way of minimizing costs.
UNATU believes stopping commercialization of education can only be achieved by revamping public schools, building more public schools, improving funding to public schools, stepping up compliance to minimum standards, and rolling out robust monitoring regulatory framework.
A school where every child is taught by a highly trained, professionally qualified teacher, a teacher who has the necessary support, decent salaries and working conditions.
While launching the campaign, the commissioner in charge of basic and secondary education, Ismail Mulindwa, who represented the permanent secretary in the Ministry of Education, admitted that over-liberalization of education was a regrettable mistake because schools went into hands of business people.
We may not stop private schools, because to be sincere to you, government may not have the capacity at the moment to provide education every Ugandan in all parts of the country. We may still need some private schools.
Government committed on behalf of the Ministry of Education to address gaps in universal primary education to improve quality of education offered in public schools.
To take this campaign forward on increasing funding for public education.
Report compiled by Fred Kajubi for the news.
Yes, so we have listened to that, but also I would like to bring in Patrick. Patrick is the National Secretary for FENAE, which is a Federation of Non-State Education Institutions. So in short, you're on the other side of the states, which is the private sector. I'm just wondering, do these high school fees translate to quality education?
Definitely yes, because there is a saying that if you pay peanuts, you expect monkeys. Two, that if you want something of quality, it has a cost. And if any country wants to be a quality country, it has to spend on social services, to spend on infrastructure, to spend on nation building. And that's the reason most sub-Saharan countries are borrowing. And to bring this question to the context for which we are discussing, it's not correct to think that the costs in education or a lot of money is paid by private schools only. There are government secondary schools that are known running private wings in those various schools, and they charge more money than private schools. But you also need to know, and all those watching us, that government literally pays everything in government schools. It pays for salaries for teachers, it stocks libraries, it stocks laboratories, it gives money for both wage and non-wage. It offers support to the recurrent wage that a school has to have utilities. It has to pay for infrastructure. Government pays. But they go ahead and have some charges, both boarding and day schools. Then when it comes to a purely private school, government contributes nothing in terms of money, apart from a conducive environment and a good policy environment. But in terms of subsidies, in terms of capitation, there is no money that any school gets. In the past, there used to be a program called secondment, where when UPE was introduced, there could be teachers who would be seconded to teach in private schools. I think by then, the bulge of students was too big to manage. But that ended. When I was in primary school some years back, we used to have scholastic materials. You know that every term coming, government of Uganda, property of government of Uganda, not for sale. You get a book, you get a pen. So yes,
you're taking us to a different issue there.
It resonates to requirements which they talked about, and which is a cost.
We are going to get into that conversation of our school requirements. Brother Patrick here raises a very interesting issue where the government is subsidizing you as government schools, and you also have fees, the school fees that you charge. Why? Why do you have to increase them even when you already have these subsidies from government, but then you still go ahead and want to match the current cost of living?
At least you put it well, you call it a subsidy.
Yes.
And I don't agree with Mr. Kabuyu, absolutely, when he says the government pays for everything in the school. That money is not there, and everybody knows. This is why parents are running away from UPE schools, particularly in urban areas. They are saying UPE schools, that it's like, we say it is a Chiwempe, a Chidandali school, Okay, so they don't want.
Is your school UPE?
Yes, my school is UPE.
Yes,
but it's government aided.
Okay,
it's partly. This is a fully traditional boarding school.
Yes,
and the government. I would say I have 1,250 children in the school. And okay, for me, I will talk about myself. I think I'm in that category Mr. Kawi is trying to put up, that we charge whatever we charge. For instance, I have a budget of around 2 billion shillings with those children, the 1,250 children. Mm-hmm. And the government will give me, the government gives me, like, at most, I have received 7 million a term on a budget of 2 billion Ugandan shillings, which budget caters for feeding children, paying for utilities, buying. Actually, in my school, we did away with our parents. The management and the parents agreed that they can't really keep carrying these things every academic term, carrying them back home and bringing them back to school, the children's requirements.
Okay.
Like, including
About the mattress.
Including mattresses, including stationery, including whatever. Because we have parents from all over the country, from as far as Arua, from as far as in Tungamo or whatever, all these parents are coming at our school, and some of them will find it so hard. Some of them are traveling by private means, and you know, carrying those mattresses, carrying everything. So the parents decided that they pay some amount of money so they don't have to come with anything. Practically, a child comes empty-handed with just the kind of clothes he's putting on. When he arrives at school, he puts it off and he goes into our uniforms, and then they have to be there with everything, pens, books, stationery, everything you can imagine is all in one. It has been around 1.6 million that we charge and a term, and now it has gone to around 1.8. We increased by around 200,000.
Yes,
which we really believe it was.
Just another question on that. Is it that there is a going rate, let's say, on the market that you should be charging or you should increase by? Because most schools, for example, Immaculate Heart Girls School, which is a secondary school, increased by 50,000. St. Mary's College, Chitende, was charging 2.2 million shillings and then went up to 2.49. Now, that is an increment of about 200,000. And indeed, when you go to some schools, they have those increments between 50,000 and 250,000. So is it
some have gone to even 500,000?
Yes.
Depending.
How do you determine that amount by which you should increase?
You know,
do you use, let's say, an inflationary rate? How do you charge that?
Let's be realistic.
Yes.
We are not living outside Uganda. Many of us who have been living here.
Yes.
One, schools were overwhelmed by that time of the COVID lockdown. When we are locked down for 2 years, I have always said institutions like schools are usually going concern. Okay? They are either developing or they are regressing. They never stand still. Institutions never stand still. Even when you lock us down, there are expenses that have to be incurred. By the time we opened up, for instance, we are paying for security for the schools. We are maintaining the schools, you know, so that we don't have anthills, you know. Growing up, you had a lot of shouting that anthills had grown, had come up in, you know, head teachers' offices and everywhere, and everybody was laughing. Look at these schools, what is this, during the lockdown? And they are now the utilities, especially. I came to realize we almost had no decrease in the payments we are making to Umeme. to National Water and Sewerage Corporation, it almost remained the same because some of our employees actually remain at the schools. They have nowhere else to go.
They remained during that time.
The schools were receiving no money at all, including UPE funds. And then here, where we are spending, many of these schools had loans, bank loans. By the time we opened, banks had put interest rates, higher interest rates, they had increased. We have issues like pay as you earn, like NSSF, okay? And some employees that remained in the schools to maintain these schools had to be paid. By the time we opened, there was, you know, so many expenses we are overwhelmed with. Now, for instance, in our case, and I'm sure it happened to so many schools, when we opened in term one, we had certain issues, like children were coughing, they had flus, they had, you know, they rejected the food we are giving them. They rejected it. I think the 2 years they had been at home, they were used to KFC foodstuffs, to whatever. And a number of us had to change, you know, the menu of these children to fit, to get closer to the menu they were feeding at home. Now, in second term, I just on foodstuffs alone, I mind a lot the feeding of my children. I know children at that level, primary school level, go by, I think it's Freud, education philosopher, Freud, who said all the philosophy and psychology of children at that age, primary school going age, is about eating. Eating, eating, eating. You don't feed them, they'll never love the school. They'll never perform. Mm. We believe in a healthy the mind in a healthy body. That's what we believe in. So for me, with feeding children, I would rather put all the money parents give me on the feeding of these children.
Very
remember,
interesting.
We adjusted the feeding of the children. I came to realize it was by around 420 million shillings, according to the figures I have now. Mm-hmm. 420 million shillings. Imagine, in second term, and then we had not adjusted school fees. I remember I was here and everybody was begging that at least let's increase the tuition next year, at the beginning of the year. Otherwise, it is taking also parents, by surprise, because everything was going high and high. All costs, all standards of living, in the marketplace costs were all going high.
Very interesting.
Engineered, you know, taken off by the fuel. We know the fuel crisis we had with the Russia and Ukraine and whatever.
Yes.
So people thought we are going to, you know, we are not going to feed the children, so we would give them just posho. And these children were falling sick very seriously. And actually, when we changed the menu, many schools changed the menu during the second term, and it really worked out. And we saw our children getting healthier and happier at school. Third term, we had teachers, our staff, they were just like you, because they couldn't, the salaries we are giving them couldn't match this the hiked now standards of living. I've had even the police recently, I think the media published some information that the police salaries are going to be increased to match with the standards of living right now. Now, we had our teachers, the staff, they were all crying that the salary couldn't really go. They started in second term, we had to bear with it. That's now I'm talking about Mugwanya Preparatory School, Kabodia. Third term, we couldn't bear it anymore because we knew teachers would not teach. They were all fending for themselves.
Very
we had to increase their salaries.
Brother.
Now tell me, without increasing tuition, for the last 5 years, we had never revised our tuition. For the last 5 years. Hmm? And here we are with all this pressure. And then you think we should remain, we are not, we are not just pieces of wood. that will remain the same pieces of wood like these ones forever. No, we are growing. We are human beings that move with our surroundings.
That's a very interesting one, brother. There, I want to bring in Patrick. He has given all the reasons why the schools have had to increase the school fees from what they used to be last year to what they are now. But earlier, there was a statement, a press release by the National Private Educational Institutions Association of Uganda, which was responding to the ministry directive about not increasing school fees. And they talked about the liberalization of the education sector. Mm. Now, are private schools in this to provide an education as well, or they are there to have to have profit because it is a business and the government liberalized this sector so someone can get into it for business? Are we seeing the private schools doing business and not minding about the education standards of the children?
Thank you. That association is a member of the umbrella, yes. The federation.
Yes.
To answer you, it is a yes and no. Yes and no, because we are not an island as actors in the sector. There is a policy at macro level, which is the privatization policy. You cannot do away with it because it has been there. So the only thing here we should do is to look at that policy and develop micro policies to help the operations of different institutions. As we speak, I'm aware that efforts to have a policy on provision of private education services is in offing, and with discussions that all stakeholders, including parents, teachers, and students, should be involved to discuss and not have the policy as a boardroom issue, but rather it should be to the public. And to answer you, whether people are making profits, there are those who are making profits and there are those who are giving a service. But largely, it is not possible to sit and think that profits are coming out only when you have tested the waters. Like in Uganda, they say, atamukute. Yeah, you can say, oh, that man, I can wrestle. Yeah, I can wrestle. But when they say, have the gloves and now can we start, you might not deliver as when you are outside. And in fact, whenever you see managers delivering, subordinates or others who are not in that office think things are easy, but when you give them a week, a month to test, they really feel the heat. So equally, there are those institutions that are making profits, there are those that are struggling. But in all this, for me, really, from our side of view, is to have an honest discussion of cost sharing. Okay. Cost sharing is going to deliver quality education. You need to know that for every parent gives you their child, you find that this is the only child they have, maybe the only girl in the family or the only son. So they want you to offer the best, whether in the village, whether in the city. So when they bring this child for you to deliver the best, there has to be a cost. But this cost elsewhere in the countryside, parents are still sleeping, saying, oh, no, we gave birth. The president will cater for these children, will educate them. And what have we seen when PLE results came for last year is that all those who have not got the result slip, that they went through the system and have been branded failed.
Declared failures.
Failures after 7 years or so, is that the parents thought, I will get money drink it or waste it and don't put investment in my child. Because the local leaders, right from LC1 in the countryside, by the way, those who have not posted the results to enable them pass are not from cities, are not from urban areas. They are from
the rural areas.
Mm. But those rural areas, every rural area has a local government, has a parish, has an LC1, has a sub-county.
Okay.
So the sub-county chief should be asked to answer why for 7 years these people have not passed. Maybe they need to speak to the powers that, you know what, we need a cost, and that cost should be to facilitate a good student, as brother has told you, basing on Sigmund Freud, who had the philosophy of feeding, that you should feed a child. Are you aware that a child, for growth and development, is supposed to drink milk every day?
Yes.
There are schools, I know your child, you, the moderator, drinks milk every day, so is my child.
And what's the cost of milk?
And what's the cost
of the
liter?
Has it increased during the course
and
of the year?
And we mean milk, which is not water, which is not water color.
Exactly.
But if the child is to take milk, to develop the cognition, to be able to understand facts, because if you are hungry, how will you listen to the teacher? You cannot play when you are hungry. You will fall down, fall flat. So for those costs to be met, a parent has to fork some money, and this money might not be so much. They should sit in their parents' meeting. Every school should be given the opportunity to sit and discuss. And let's not say courts are going to remove children from school, not complete. Instead, costs, if agreed through school management committees and boards of governors, will motivate learners to stay in school because they are eating the food. And let parents contribute food in form of fees if they cannot pay, so that he has an obligation to deliver matoke, bunches, and cereals to the school, transform it into tuition. And there we shall be moving, catching up, and the issue of school charges will be addressed.
Okay, so you have both made a case whereby the costs that the school has to incur have gotten to be paid for by someone, whether it's government or the parent. But according to Article 30 of the Constitution, it provides that every child has, or every Ugandan has, a right to education. But this is now coming at a very high cost for the parents. How would you advise struggling parents to deal with these financial challenges, and yet they have to get their children to attain an education?
By the way, that's a dilemma to us, and to me that question is coming to the wrong people. I think we have economists in this country who can answer such a question better. I wish I could do away with every coin that a parent pays for these children, and I teach them free of charge. I wish I had a way of doing it. You don't know how much I want to see every Ugandan, whether retarded or whatever, studying to the point of getting at least a bachelor's degree. I'm somebody who has moved, you know, I don't know, call me a globetrotter if you want, but I have moved to so many countries, okay? I was in Ireland, actually, recently, with a new vision, as a teacher making a difference.
Yes.
And we are studying these same whatever systems. Finland, a country I admire, which is said to have the best education system in the whole world. It's free education. Somebody, it was a third world country, and somebody one time dreamed, got that dream, because these are basically fishermen who didn't care about the education of their people. And they say, well, there was this angelic guy in the government who came up with an idea and said, no, we want to have education for all. And it meant education for all. Here it is not education for all. He was talking
what
of, we was talking of UNEB declaring a whole million children.
What is it here?
Failures. No, it is not. It is education for all in, you know, in talking. But in practice, you find a different thing. Now, if UNEB themselves, they have to, there are many government agencies that are collecting money from schools,
yes,
including UNEB. You have to pay for exams. These people know. You have to pay taxes. We have to pay whatever. So by even if you charge 1,000, there will be a parent who will refuse to give it, mm-hmm, and prefers drinking that 1,000 shillings so that his children, the children remain at home. Mm-hmm. Finland has been declared the happiest country in the whole world. They're the happiest people. Mm-hmm. In hardly 15 years, they moved from third world country to first world country by educating all their people for free of charge. And the moment everybody, the Baganda here say, onalia nulialia, yemere jirachi, yemere woma. The moment you have everybody, you know, paying taxes, there is hardly somebody who will go to a bachelor's degree, okay, who will not pay taxes, who will not pay taxes, at least pay as you earn. Eh? There is that pay as you earn, you are being, you know, the taxes, the taxes will increase definitely. Everybody I've seen now with the URA, praising pay as you earn, that you know they are overshooting their targets. They have collecting more money than what they are targeted for. And the first the section that they were praising that gave them more money was pay as you earn, okay, which comes from these people who are basically employed, and these are basically educated people.
Okay. Now, let me just bring in Patrick a little to tell us how you would advise parents who are struggling financially, because we are just going for a short break, but can I just pick your mind on that just quickly?
Thank you. We are all struggling, mm-hmm, and you've heard people talk about the struggle. The country's borrowing, the parents is borrowing for school fees, money lenders are on every parent's neck, commercial banks are almost on every person,
mm-hmm,
so government must come out to subsidize living. How do you subsidize living? During COVID, it would have given a package to every parent in terms of stimulus package for life.
Mm.
But we also saw that when we talk about those countries, Finland, Denmark, mention them, even Zimbabwe here, Zambia near us, their populations are smaller, are manageable. The size of those countries are bigger than ours, Zimbabwe, but however small we are in geography, the population is too much.
Yes.
So you cannot expect quality if, for instance, you have about 7 to 9 or 10 people in your household, in your own home where you stay. You know the quality of food you will prepare. The soup will be watery, the milk won't be real, everything will be in short. So for us to improve sustainably, government must check on the population, there has to be a control, there has to be cost sharing, and for parents not to have the pressure, government should extend something for every home. The way it is for old people who are getting 23,000, can we see that come?
Okay, thank you very much, Patrick. You are watching The Checkpoint with me, Vivian Kamsime, and these two gentlemen here on my left. We will be right back.